What happens to sexual function in men after spinal cord injury or neurological disorders or something as common as polyneuropathy from diabetes? It is a very complicated topic. I mean, very complicated. I gave it a long thought and came to the conclusion that it is impossible to explain it in 1 5-minute video. So in this video, I will lay the anatomical foundation so that you will get acquainted with the basics of erection and orgasm on a neurological level. What happens if nerves are damaged due to spinal cord injury, trauma, surgery, radiation, or neurological disease? In the videos to come, I will frequently refer back to this video, so it is definitely worth watching. If you look at the neurological wiring of the body, there is the central nervous system, which consists of the brain and the spinal cord. And then there is the peripheral nervous system, which are single nerves traveling through the body to their respective target areas. The peripheral nervous system can be broken down into the somatic nervous system and the autonomic nervous system. One could roughly say that the somatic nervous system has to do with things we can do at will, and that the autonomous nervous system is connected to all the stuff which is beyond our control, such as heartbeat, blood pressure, bowel movement, and so on. Within the autonomous nervous system, there is an activating part, the so-called sympathetic nervous system, and a relaxing part, the so-called parasympathetic nervous system. The somatic nervous system has nerves which transfer information to the central nervous system. This is when you touch something, how it feels, is it cold, hot, etc. And there are nerves which transfer information from the central nervous system, for example, to move your legs when you want to walk. I am telling you this because for sex, you need all of it. You need your brain, your spinal cord, your peripheral nervous system with somatic nerves, sympathetic and parasympathetic fibers. Any disruption of the complex interplay of the different components will result in impaired sexual function. Of course, there are also hormones, blood vessels, and various chemicals involved, but for the purpose of this video, let's focus on the nerves. What you need to remember for spinal cord injuries is at which level of the spinal cord the injury occurs and whether that injury damages the spinal cord completely or incompletely. In order to understand what this means, you will have to understand the vertebral versus the cord segmental levels. Within the spine, there is a canal which harbors the spinal cord. If we just look at the bony structure of the spine first, we divide it into the cervical, the thoracic, the lumbar, and the sacral spine. The cervical spine consists of 7 vertebrae, the thoracic has 12, the lumbar 5, and the sacral spine 5 vertebrae. Within the spinal cord, there are segmental levels too. These are neurological segments, and when we talk about them, they correspond to the nomenclature we use for the bony spine. So we are talking about C1 to 7 for the cervical spinal cord segments, T1 to 12, and so on. However, the spinal cord doesn't follow the bony spine all the way down, but ends somewhere around at level of the first to second lumbar vertebrae. From there, it sends a bunch of nerves downwards, which altogether resemble the tail of a horse. Therefore, it bears the name cauda equina. The segments of the spinal cord kind of correspond to the respective vertebrae, although slightly shifted because it is somewhat shorter than the spinal column. So now that you know the anatomical foundation, we can start to talk about the consequences for sexual function when the spinal cord gets damaged. Erection is controlled by parasympathetic fibers originating from S2 to S4. Ejaculation is coordinated by the spinal cord involving both sympathetic fibers from the segments T10 to L2 and somatic fibers from S2 to S4. The somatic input has a name. It's the dorsal nerve of the penis, which gets activated by stimulation of the glands. So any injury of the spinal cord, be it complete or incomplete, will have negative effects upon sexuality. Roughly 3/4 of men with spinal cord injuries will suffer from erectile dysfunction. In those with erections, many don't reach a rigidity which would be sufficient for intercourse. It also depends a lot of the level of damage. I will come to this in a separate video. Concerning ejaculation, it also depends on the level of the lesion and whether it is complete or incomplete. In complete spinal cord disruption, only 4% of the men with high lesions are able to ejaculate, whereas the reflex is preserved in 18% of the men with low lesions. In the next video, I will explain reflexogenic and psychogenic erections and how they are affected by neural damage. Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.